So a few months ago, Davide contacted me to ask me to speak about the linear response theory, and I never looked at the school website, so I discovered yesterday I should have the title of my talk was this. So beyond the independent particle scheme, the linear response theory. Actually, I will almost not go beyond the independent particle scheme, so I would stick to my original, let's say, plan. Okay, so often in physics, we study the response of the system to external perturbation to gain information on intrinsic properties of the material. To have just think a little more about this concept, we might just think about a bell. When we ring the bell, we hear a sound, and this sound is providing us an information on its elementary excitation. And these normal modes could also be used to guess its structure, to know if, yeah, maybe we don't see the bell, but we can guess if it's a very small bell or it's very large or whatever. Similarly, with the electronic system. So we can perturb the electronic system with external electromagnetic field or in elastic scattering with charged particles, and we can gain information about the system. So, for instance, if we think about a light absorption experiment, we gain information, indirect information on the electronic structure, the bus structure, and we can also understand if many body effects are more strong or less strong in the system. So this is the plan for today's lesson. So first of all, I will try to derive a microscopic formulation to describe the response of the electronic system to an external perturbation. We will apply this general formulation to the case of the density-density response function, and then we will try to link these quantities to experiments and to the material world. And finally, we will just provide some preliminary approximation to see how it works, okay? So we start with our definition of our system. We are in a microscopic world, so we have the Hamiltonian, which we divide into two parts. In this case, at odds with what Gianluca showed you, we have H0, which might contain also all the interaction, and we apply an external perturbation, which we suppose is weak and is time dependent. This external perturbation, in general, can be written like this. So we have a field that depends, might depend on the position and on time, and that is coupled to an observable belonging to the of the system. As I told you, is worth remembering that this H0 is not a way of writing an non-interacting Hamiltonian, might be also fully interacting in principle. Just similarly to what Gianluca just showed you, we are interested in evaluating. We are interested in evaluating the expectation value of an operator O, of an observable O on the system at time t, and see how it deviates from the unperturbed case, from the case in which this external perturbation is not applied. Okay, so here I just write the Schrödinger equation. And of course, we know that in the Schrödinger representation, we know that we can evolve the system following these rules, and without the perturbation, we write it without H external. Okay, suppose we switch on the perturbation at t equal time equal t zero, and we rewrite the same equation in the interaction picture. That means that we just write this cat in the interaction picture in terms of the cat in the Schrödinger representation, adding this exponential here, and here H0 appears. Then we rewrite also the operators in this way, and if this true, these two, we take these two definitions, we. Oh, sorry. Okay, I missed one formula. Okay, we have also. No. Ah, okay, I was going backwards. I'm sorry because I used the pointer and then. Okay, so we have that the cat. In the interaction picture, follow the time evolution follow this rule over here. Okay. So what do we do next? The plan is this: we integrate this equation of motion. We solve it to the first order in the external perturbation. We plug this result in the equation of motion for in the Schrödinger picture, and then we compute the expectation value. Finally, we obtain this expectation value, and we express it in terms of response functions, and we Fourier transform in time and look at what is the information that we have in these quantities. Okay, so first of all, we integrate the equation of motion. So we have that the evolved state at time t is given by the state at t0 plus this integral over here. Okay. Note that at t equal t0, the state in the interaction picture is just the same as in the Schrödinger case. So now we need to solve this equation to the first order in the external potential. So we iterate this one time. Okay. And then we keep only the first order terms in H external. To do this, by iterate, I mean that I just, you know, here the state at time t prime appears. So we just plug this same formulation to, that is this term in square parentheses. And yeah, and so we have the expression of the state at times t prime in terms of the state at time t0. Plus the integral. Okay, if we neglect this this is correct. So if we neglect now terms that are beyond the first order in each external, we obtain this approximated evolved state over here. Okay. Okay, so now we need just to plug this result in the equation of motion for the in the Schrödinger picture. And to do this, we just take the result that we had before and just multiply by this exponential. And then we take the expectation value. If we do this in a few lines, you can see that you get this result over here. So we have that the expectation value of the observable O at time t is given by its value at time t0, let's say, on this plus this term, in which we see that we get the commutator between the external Hamiltonian and the operator O. Okay, note that these are here still operators which are treated at the interaction in the interaction picture. Okay, so this actually doesn't mean that we are computing this average at time t0. Okay. Next, so the next step is to express these expectation values in terms of to get the fluctuation in terms of the response function, then Fourier transform it to look at what information we can get. So now, if we consider that the state is originally at its ground state, we have that the fluctuation, so we just bring to the right to the left part, the expectation, the first term, we obtain that we have this equation here for the fluctuations. Okay. If now we define the macroscopic response function, the OP, in this way, okay, we can rewrite this fluctuation as an integral over time and over the full volume of this macroscopic response function defined by the this equation over here and the external field. Okay, so the step I took, maybe I didn't say it here, was to just to write the H external as the product between the field and the operator P to which it is coupled. Okay. So now we Fourier transform this quantity. Before doing this, we plug in the identity, and so we consider all the possible eigenstates of the possibly interacting H0, and we obtain this is what's a so-called Lehmann representation for the OP response function. What if we take a look at this? What is okay? What can we learn? We see that the poles of the response functions are at the excitation energies of the system. And moreover, we see that the numerators, in the numerators, we have this the expectation value between the, let's say, the observable O or P and the ground state and the excited state, M. So we have an information on how the ground state is coupled by the observables to the excited state of excitation epsilon M minus epsilon zero, okay? EM minus E zero. So let's, okay, this is completely general. O and P can be any observable, but let's apply it to the case of density-density response function. In this case, we have that external perturbation is given by an external potential, which is coupled to the electronic density. The expectation, what we are looking, what we will probe are the fluctuation of the density. So in this case, we just, what we have to do is just to replace O and P with N, okay? And we obtain for the fluctuation of the density, we obtain this, this expression, of course, in which we introduce the density-density microscopic response function. And if we Fourier transform it, we, just get the similar results as we've seen here, but what we can learn more is that in this case, what is coupling the M excited state to the ground state is the density operator, and this means that through the density-density response function, we are actually accessing the and energies and the properties of neutral excitations. Okay, so just to summarize what we've seen up to now. We were looking for a microscopic description of how the electronic system is responding to an external perturbation. We saw that if we can consider all the contributions up to the first order, the retarded response function stem naturally, okay? If we Fourier transform this response function, we see that they carry information on the excitation of the system and how, and carry also information on how these observables are coupled, these observables couple this excited state with the ground state. And then we got an expression for the microscopic density-density response function. Okay, the next small step we take is to introduce other microscopic ingredients which we will need to really be able to get a connection with the experiments. Okay, these two ingredients are the so-called irreducible response function and the microscopic dielectric function. So, if we recall just the equation that relates the fluctuation of the density with external potential, potential, we have this density-density response function, which in the jargon of many body perturbation theory actually is a retarded reducible response function, also called reducible polarizability. I'm telling you these names just because during this school I think you will hear them many times, and you have also heard it just heard it with Gianluca's talk. So just to we can introduce, besides this chi, this reducible response function, the irreducible response function P, which now links the density fluctuations with the total potential. Okay, so since this is the total potential, it also includes the polarization of the system, that is how the electronic system rearranges itself as responding, let's say, self-consistently to the external perturbation. Okay, we have these two equations, but of course the chi and P must be somehow related, and they are related by the fact that the total potential is nothing but the external potential plus the induced potential. And the induced potential is linked to the fluctuation of the density, because it's given by the, let's say, you see here, we have the fluctuation of the density at position R2, and then we have the Coulomb potential, which says what is the potential felt at R1 due to all the charge that is displaced in all the R2. Okay, so if now we close we use this information and we use it in this tool by rewriting V dot as the sum of V external and V induced, it's very easy to show that we get this equation that is a closer equation relating the reducible chi to the irreducible P. And this is just a sort of Dyson, it's a Dyson-like equation for chi. And you see that is a Dyson equation. It's very similar to what Gianluca showed you before, because we have chi over here, then we have this P, and we have a P here, then we have the what in Gianluca's slide was the self-energy in this case, and this was G0 and G0, and then we have again the full chi, okay? So these kind of equations are very useful, because of course maybe you cannot solve them in every case, but in principle you can invert them, you know, and so you can actually, if you give some approximation to some of the terms, you can also solve them. Okay, the other microscopic ingredient I want to introduce is the microscopic dielectric function. The microscopic dielectric function is the function that connects the external potential to the total potential that is acting at one point. So, is bearing information directly on the screening, on how the electronic system is screening the external potential to then finally create a total potential, an overall potential. So this is just the definition of the microscopic dielectric function. And again, by taking into account that the total potential is nothing but the sum of the external and induced potential, that the induced potential is linked to the density fluctuation, we can express the microscopic dielectric function in terms either of the reducible chi And in this case, just going through the equations, you see that is the inverse of the dielectric function that appears, or to the irreducible P. And in this case, we have a direct link with epsilon. Okay, so next, we try to relate these quantities to the experiments. And then we introduce, as I said, some very rough approximation to compute them in the most simple way and just see how it works. Okay, the connection with the spectroscopy is very fast. It's nothing but this. You can read a lot, but at the end of the day, what is important for us today is that, for instance, we want to simulate electron energy loss spectra that describe the inelastic scattering of electrons impinging on a sample, or we want to describe an absorption experiment. In both cases, the quantity we need to address is this macroscopic dielectric function. It's macroscopic, so it's not microscopic. So we need to find a way to compute this epsilon m. Okay, we said, okay, it's easy. We have the microscopic dielectric function. We find the proper way to average this, and we get the macroscopic quantity. Okay, first, we have to be very pay attention at this point. All this discussion I just told you just was hiding some subtle things, more or less, maybe not so subtle. First of all, we must take into account that truly there is the dielectric function has a tensor nature. Okay, it connects the in the Maxwell equation, let's say, the constitutive equation that accompany the Max equation, it connects the electric displacement vector to the electric field. And it has both, let's say, longitudinal and transverse component. What I mean by this? Okay, any vector can be decomposed in its longitudinal, that is parallel to the direction of propagation, and transverse component. So truly, the dielectric function is a dielectric is a tensor, and in principle, we see that the we can have that the longitudinal and the transverse component might mix, and what we know. This is a, I will go very short on this, but what we know is that actually it's a symmetry that is regulating this fact. So if we are in a high symmetry condition, for instance, in cubic systems, we know that the off-diagonal elements of this tensor are zero. And if we are in low symmetry, we can what we can say is that if we propagate along the principal axis of the crystal also, we don't have this kind of mixing. What is important to know, why I'm saying all this, is that the quantity that we just computed, the microscopic dielectric function that we just computed in terms of the density-density response function, is actually corresponding to the longitudinal, to this term over here. So this is the quantity that is easily addressable, or we can address with that kind of formula that I showed you before. In principle, if we're dealing with optical experiments, we have a transverse perturbation, we should not use it. What can be shown, and okay, in Landau is say that is obvious, in other papers is three pages of formulas for cubic systems, so it's not trivial at all, but in the optical limit, we can use the microscopic dielectric dielectric function that I showed you before, that is related to the density-density response function, also for the transverse case. So in the optical limit, we can still use this the longitudinal dielectric function also for describing optical experiments. Okay, so once we keep in mind these warnings, we go to the macroscopic average. We are dealing with periodic system. We then Fourier transform also in the space variables so that we can express the response function in this way. It is a matrix in GG prime space and a function of Q and omega. Okay. The relation I was showing you before in real space, in this case with the inverse of the electric function, this is all microscopic up to now, is given by this equation over here, below. Okay. Okay, so if we are in a long wavelength limit, this means that the wavelength of our system is much, much larger than the typical dimension of the cell of our crystal. So, looking at the quantities that we have in our microscopic description, we have that external potential, the fields are slowly varying. Instead, the total potential and the induced potential, and total fields and induced potentials, they actually can vary very rapidly because they represent, they add on top of the external potential the response of the system. So, to take the macroscopic average, we must average on distances which are small with respect to lambda and large with respect to the unit cell. And what prescription do we use? We will average, since the system is periodic, we will average over unit cell whose origin is at R. And then we regard this R, which in principle is discrete because it's the Bravais lattice vector, is as a continuous variable. So let's take a look at how we can make this macroscopic average of a given microscopic potential. Okay, so here what we do is this. So first of all, we express any microscopic potential in if we are in the presence of a lattice in this way. we sum over all the G vectors and integrate in the first brilliant zone, or sum over the Q vectors and the brilliant zone. What we can do is to, first of all, sum up over G. If we do this, we are left with this equation in the bottom, in which we see we have a sum over Q of this phase factor times a function which has the periodicity of the Bravais lattice. So this is nothing but the block function. What we want to get, our target is to get the macroscopic average of this potential. So we see here that we want to get something like this. So what we need to average is this V of Q, R and omega over a unit cell to get the Q component of the macroscopic potential. If we do this, we just rewrite it in terms of its component, of its G components, we can see very quickly that only the G equals zero component survives. This means that the Q component of the, to obtain the Q component of the macroscopic potential, we have to just take the G equals zero component of the microscopic quantity. Okay, of course, if we have purely macroscopic quantities, all the G different from zero components are already at the beginning equal to zero. So our target, we say, is to get, let's say, this macroscopic dielectric function, which connects the external potential in the macroscopic world to the total potential. So let's apply the macroscopic average directly in the equation that in which the microscopic dielectric function appears. To take the macroscopic average of this equation here, we said we just need to take the zero component of the the g equals zero component of the microscopic quantity. If we do this, we see at the left that we obtain the macroscopic external potential, but on the right, we are left with the sum over g prime, okay? Which is of course different from writing something like taking also the zero zero component of the electric microscopic dielectric function and use it directly in this formula. So we and so if we compare this the equation on the top with this last one, we see that this is not the way we must proceed. What we can do instead is to invert this relation and to use the relation which relates the total potential to the external potential through the inverse microscopic dielectric function. First of all, we notice that on the right we have the external potential, which is a macroscopic quantity, and therefore has all its g prime different from zero component equal to zero. So first of all, already in the microscopic world, we are left with this equation over here. We now take the macroscopic average and we find that the Q component of the total potential is linked to the Q component of the external potential through the zero zero component of the inverse microscopic dielectric function. Therefore, to to really obtain the macroscopic dielectric function, we must really calculate the microscopic inverse dielectric function, compute its head, that is its zero zero g equal g prime equal zero component, and then we invert this, and that's a number of function, and we get what we need to be able to compare with experiments. So this is the proper, let's say, macroscopic average that must be taken. Okay, so we have this, now we know that we can access the experimental quantities through calculating this element of the microscopic electric, microscopic inverse electric function. What we can say more is that if the system was were homogeneous, then the all its let's say in the microscopic dielectric function all is its g different from zero component would be equal to zero. In this case, we would have that this inequality would become this non-equal would become an equal. So, and we could use directly this the epsilon zero zero. So this also tells us that if we don't go through the calculation of the inverse dielectric function, but directly want to let's say use the epsilon zero zero component of the microscopic dielectric function to describe for our spectra, actually we are neglecting all the effects of the inhomogeneity of the system. So now we have all the things we need to let's say start computing a spectrum. So we I just recall here all the equations that we have let's say developed up to now. We have that the correct quantities that we want to the quantity that we want to address is this microscopic dielectric function that is given as 1 over the zero zero component of the inverse of the microscopic dielectric function. We have that if we accept of neglecting the local fields that are the effects of the inhomogeneity of the system, we could actually write it in this other way here. And then we have at the microscopic level, we have that the microscopic dielectric, the inverse microscopic dielectric function can be expressed in terms of the reducible polarizability, that the dielectric function can be expressed in terms of the reducible polarizability P, and that the two quantities are connected together through this Dyson-like equation, and this also makes it very clear why, in principle, one could say, okay, but maybe I can, let's say, use epsilon microscopic directly to avoid any matrix inversion and have my spectrum. So this is why we really need to take into account the possibility of neglecting the local fields, no? Because we see here that if we say we give an approximation for, we give an expression for P, no? In principle, one could get directly from a given expression for P, one could get directly the microscopic epsilon. But to get then the quantity of interest, that is its inverse, we should invert it in G space. And or the other way around, we should compute chi through an inversion and then get the epsilon minus one. Okay, so the first approximation we can make is to consider the system as made of independent particles. In this case, so the particles are not interacting, we have that P is equal to K0, and K0 is given by this expression here. And what we see here is that this non-interacting density-density response function, in this response function, we have that the poles are located at single particle transition energies. That is, we have a non-interacting system, so we shine light, we excite an electron from one of its single particle state to that is occupied, so from a valence state to a state in the conduction. And the energy of this excitation is exactly this energy difference. We also, okay, given this, let's say, approximate expression for P, we can then say, okay, we neglect local fields. So we compute directly the macroscopic dielectric function, we take its zero, zero element, and then we have the spectrum. If we do this, we see that the absorption spectrum is given by an expression that is this expression over here, which is just a sum over all the possible independent single particle transitions of delta peaks that are located at the single particle transition energies, which are weighted by the transition dipole moments. Okay. Here we see also how, what I was telling you before, that here we have that not all the single particle transition contribute, because they are transition where this matrix element is zero due to symmetry reason, for instance, and in this case that single particle transition would not contribute to the spectrum. Okay. We can, in another way, we can instead include the local fields. So if we want to do this, we have to compute the epsilon minus one. To compute epsilon minus one, we need know chi, the reducible response function. So we plug the chi zero in the Dyson-like equation for chi, and then we invert this equation and get the head, the zero G equals G prime equals zero component of the matrix, and get the macroscopic dielectric function in this way. So just to finish, how does spectra look like in these cases? Okay, so in this case we have the example of the absorption spectrum of solid beryllium, here small. We start from this one. In red, we have the spectrum computed without local fields, and in black, we have the spectrum computed including local fields. And we see that in the case of the solid, there is almost no effect. On the other hand, in the larger picture, we have the same quantity computed for the beryllium atom. Here we see that the local field effects are actually very large. And this is like something we could already have understood. The more the system is homogeneous, the less important are the local field effect. Okay. Here we have another example that is, I think, in every Yambo school has been shown. That in this case we have a 1D system. This is a germanium nanowires, and we have the optical absorption spectrum computed on the left for light which is polarized along the nanowire axis. Whereas on the right, we have the absorption spectrum for light that is polarized perpendicularly to the nanowire axis. In the top, we see the results that are obtained neglecting local fields. Whereas in the bottom, we have included the local fields. Again, we see, if we are probing our system in the direction in which the perturbation sees it as, let's say, homogeneous, the local fields are not very strong. In the right, instead, we see that if we probe it in the direction where we see the system is highly inhomogeneous, we see that the optical spectrum are the local fields is much more important, is quite completely important. To conclude, I leave you with this last slide, in which what the message is that, okay, we've seen that we can compute this spectroscopy, in this case, this optical absorption spectrum, include at the in a non-interacting picture, including or not including the local fields. We see that in some cases they make a difference. However, how does this compare with the experiment, or are they enough? Okay, and there are some cases in which they are really not enough. Here we have bulk silicon. In the green, we have the spectrum without local fields. In blue, we have the spectrum computed with local fields. The difference are not so large, because this is a bulk. The system is overall not so inhomogeneous. But we, if we compare it with experiments, we see that we still need some important physical ingredient, which will be introduced to you in the next lesson. Okay.
Thank you very much, Margherita. Questions? Yes.
Okay. Hi, Ms. Prof. Marsali. I'm Drew from Queen's University, Belfast. Okay, thank you for your presentation. And I got a question about the definition about of the absorption and the RPA epsilon. Yeah, as you said, for epsilon in absorption, it's just, there's no local field included, and the momentum is equal to zero. And we only need to include finite bands we need to construct the absorption. But actually, in my computational experience, when constructing RPA dielectric function, we need to include as much bands as we can to construct a dielectric function. So how to explain the difference between the epsilon when we express absorption and dielectric function?
Sorry, you said that I said that we don't need only the valence electrons.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay, so maybe I said something.
Yeah, I was asked once in a review to ask me about the absorption and the dielectric function.
Yeah.
Because as I plot two figures, one to express the dielectric screening of my system, and one epsilon figure to describe the absorption property of my system. So what's the difference between those two epsilon?
Yeah, it's exactly the macroscopic limit, I would say. Yeah? So in one case, we have the screening, which is a microscopic screening. Okay.
Micro.
With I think this is can make. So, in the microscopic world, the one that the electron sees, he sees all the inhomogeneity of the system is dimensional very time, let's say. So in this sense, when we the total fields, total field that the electron experiences is the sum of the external field plus the field that all the that the induced density is producing. And this is intrinsically varying very fast in space, okay? So this is the screening, the electronic screening. So the electron feels this microscopic potential, say, okay? What is probed, what is in the Maxwell equation, is a macroscopic quantity, okay? Indeed, you often see the macroscopic dielectric function expressed, for instance, if you have this, like an epsilon of R and omega, let's say, if you have a local variation of the, but it's just R, one R, okay? That R is this large, this capital R over here, okay? Which obtained by averaging, is obtained by averaging this, doing this macroscopic average. So that is making an average over a length which is large with respect to the unit cell, but small with respect to the wavelength, let's say. Okay. Hope that.
Any other question? Yes.
Thank you for your presentation. So I'm Prem from University of Florence. So my question is more on the application of the linear response theory, particularly to calculate the Hubbard parameters. So the Hubbard parameters, Hubbard corrections, Hubbard.
Hubbard?
Yeah. So basically, like I'm working on the field of molecular magnetism. So with the single molecule magnets and qubits. So we have some transition metal based complexes or lanthanide metal based complexes. So for that, we have this atom or metal ion. So for some of them, the value is the Hubbard U value correction is not reported. So I was so there is a package called HP package in the Quantum Espresso, which is interfaced to get the U correction using the linear response theory. So I was wondering for some atoms or ions which are not reported in the literature, how accurate the value will give in response to the experiment?
That's interesting. I admit that I don't know. I would say that as far as what I think is that this way of computing U may be the best way in order to have it, let's say, ab initio. But then its quality is not, I don't know. I don't know if any of the, about the quality of the U computed with the linear response. The Cocconi, yes. I don't know if compared with experiments, the U of Cocconi's approach is quite good. The is like a self computed in not self consistent. You know, I don't know. If what would you say?
I have no experience in this evaluation of the U parameter with the linear response.
Do you?
But if someone has experience and can provide answers.
Do you know?
It's maybe a stupid, but depends on how bad is density functional theory. So how bad is your density? Because if the density and the response of the density are completely off, I think that it's not very good. So the farther it's from something that density functional can evaluate. So how good is your density and the response? So it really depends on the system, I think.
There are other questions? Okay, if not, I will thank Margherita.
Okay, I'm from Suzhou University, and I have a question. Is the screened dielectric function is not a periodic, is not periodic, and our calculation is always in the unit cell. So how can we catch the dielectric function when the Q approach infinity?
So you say that the microscopic dielectric function is not periodic.
The microscopy is not periodic, but your calculation is periodic in your cell. Okay. How do you combine the two pictures? But you have key points. You have your key points.
When you make a supercell.
When Q approaches infinity, and the screened dielectric function should approach is one. When in a 2D material, so how when we calculate in the calculation, how can we catch this feature?
I think if I understand your question, so you're saying if I have, for example, a 2D material, then the dielectric function will tend to one. This is the point. Yeah. So what Margherita has discussed and what we usually show is mostly designed for extended systems. And then we have the relation between the response function and the dielectric function. Then, of course, if you look to a 2D material, a 1D material, then you have to be careful on how to relate the response function to what. So probably the dielectric function is not the good quantity. You can compute the polarizability in this kind of systems or other quantities depending on the experiment. Okay.
Thank you. There are other questions? If not, I would thank Margherita again.